Experiment 17 in Chem 1212 is titled Chemical Equilibrium and Beer's Law. The principles and concepts of chemical equilibrium are going to be really important to you throughout your study of chemistry. And if your future career involves chemistry in any way, shape, or form, you will use chemical equilibrium. I guarantee it. So this experiment is really important. With that in mind, this video has two major parts. First of all, I'm going to give a general introduction to chemical equilibrium, talk about how to think about it, not just how the equilibrium constant is defined and the relationship to free energy, but also how to think about it at the molecular level and think about the processes that are occurring when a system is in chemical equilibrium. In part two, we'll get a little bit closer to the actual experiment, and we'll talk about measuring the equilibrium constant K or KC or KEQ. The purpose of this experiment is going to be really to measure the equilibrium constant of the reaction of iron 3 cation with thiocyanate anion. So let's start with discussing chemical equilibrium in general. I'd like to use as a context the reaction that we're going to be investigating in this experiment, which is the coordination of the thiocyanate anion, SCN-, to the iron 3 cation, Fe3+, to form a complex FeSCN2+. It's easy enough for us to dream up this reaction and write it as you see here and cross our fingers that when we mix the reactants, they'll actually form the product that we've drawn. In practice, it's not this simple to design a working chemical reaction because it's just as possible that the reverse reaction might occur. The complex might break apart to form Fe3+ and SCN-. A key question we have as chemists is how do we know which direction, the forward or the way we've written it, or the reverse direction, is more likely? What we can say in general is that after an infinite amount of time, so that effects due to differences in rate are essentially taken off the table, both reactants and products will be present. And their relative amounts tell us whether the forward direction is favored, in which case we'll see more products, or the reverse direction is favored, in which case we'll see more reactants, or we may not see the reactants move toward product at all. This state in which the rates of the forward and reverse reactions are equal and the amounts of reactants and products are not changing with time is called chemical equilibrium. And to explore equilibrium in a little more detail, I want to think about it in terms of free energies, because that's really the origin of the state we see at chemical equilibrium. So I'll start with a free energy axis, G, that runs vertically, low energy at the bottom, high energy at the top. And we can imagine putting down the reactants and the products on this energy graph. So the starting materials here, Fe3+ and SCN-, are a little bit higher in energy than the products, let's just say, hypothetically. Now, the forward direction corresponds to moving from the higher energy reactants to the lower energy products. And once we've reached the state of chemical equilibrium, it's really important to see that for every event going from the reactants to the products, for every R to P event, there is a corresponding event in the reverse direction that converts products back to starting materials. So for every conversion of a reactant to product, there is a corresponding product to reactant event. So for every forward reaction, there is a reverse reaction event. This means that if we start with, say, 4 reactant molecules and 8 product molecules, at the state of chemical equilibrium, these amounts are not changing. For every pair of reactant molecules that's converted to products, one of the product molecules forms a pair of reactants. So at chemical equilibrium, the amounts of reactants and products are static. More correctly, the concentrations of the reactants and products are static. Put another way, the rates of the forward reaction R to P and the reverse reaction P to R are equal at this point. Notice, however, that the amounts, in other words, the numbers of moles of R and P, are not equal. I've put a little asterisk here because the one time they do end up being equal is when the reactants and products are identical. But literally, in any other case, when the reactants and products are different in any way, shape, or form, the amounts of reactants and products at equilibrium are not equal. Furthermore, there's no guarantee that we have more products than reactants or vice versa. That depends on the nature of the particular chemical system we're looking at. So if we think of a general reaction, A molecules of R going to B molecules of P, we can quantify the nature of the equilibrium state using the equilibrium constant K sub C. This is the molarity or the concentration of P raised to the B power divided by the concentration of R raised to the A power. And for more than one product or more than one reactant, we just add factors raised to their respective stoichiometric coefficient to either the numerator or the denominator, respectively. Now, KC tells us at a sufficiently large time whether we'll have more products or more reactants around. And so the equilibrium constant is a really valuable piece of information that tells us whether a reaction will work or not to some degree. So a question we have then is, how do we actually measure this? How can we study a chemical reaction to measure KC so that when another chemist comes along and wants to run this reaction to, say, synthesize the complex for some application, we can say to that chemist, yes, this reaction will work and will go to products, or no, don't even try it. It's not going to move from reactants when you mix the iron 3 and the thiocyanate. So in the remainder of this video, we'll explore how to measure KC. So how do we go about measuring KC for the coordination of thiocyanate to iron 3? Well, I see this as basically a four-step process. Two of the steps are quite easy, and two of the steps are a little bit more computationally involved. Step one is simply to mix the reactants in known concentrations or known molarities. We need to know these molarities for a later step, but of course, setting up the reaction and running it is going to be the key first step. The second step, which is the easiest of all, is simply to wait. Go grab coffee, go hang out with friends, go see a movie, go do whatever you want to do and take all the time in the world. We need to give the reaction enough time so that the forward and reverse reactions attain equal rates. Remember, in general, those rates won't be equal to start, and we need to let the reaction sort of adjust its concentrations so that the rates of the forward and reverse processes are equal, and we've attained chemical equilibrium. Once equilibrium has been achieved, the next step is to measure the concentrations of reactants and products. Once we have those in hand, we can simply plug those in to the equilibrium expression to calculate KC. Now, I won't talk about determining equilibrium expressions. You'll talk about this in lecture in great detail, and I'll just go ahead and tell you that the equilibrium constant for this reaction is equal to the concentration of the complex, or the product, divided by the concentration of Fe3+, times the concentration of SCN-. This is the so-called equilibrium expression for this reaction. And truthfully, once you understand how to write equilibrium expressions, the trickiest part of this entire process actually becomes step three, measuring concentrations. Measuring concentrations is a little bit trickier than it sounds because we can't simply peer into a solution and visually identify the number of moles of a molecule within a solution. So concentration has to be measured indirectly, and the way we'll measure it indirectly is by using Beer's law. Beer's law, remember, relates the absorbance of a colored species within a solution to the concentration of that species within a solution. In a nutshell, it says that the more molecules of an absorbing substance you have in a solution, the larger absorbance you'll see, and they're linearly related. So it relates A, or the absorbance, to, in our case, the concentration of the only absorbing species, which is the product. Only the complex absorbs light. Fe3+ and SCN- are, for all intents and purposes, transparent, particularly at the wavelength where FeSCN2+ absorbs the strongest. So we'll focus on the concentration of this species in applying Beer's law. And because we knew the concentrations of the starting materials from step one, we'll be able to just apply Beer's law to the product and back calculate the equilibrium concentrations of the reactants. The constants you see in front of the molarity of the complex term on the right-hand side of this equation are epsilon and L. L is just the path length that the light travels as it traverses the solution. For us, because all of our cuvettes are standardly built, it will be 1 centimeter across the board, and so we can essentially ignore that component of this equation. And the epsilon is what's called the molar absorptivity, and it's really the proportionality constant that tells us how much a mole of FeSCN2+ actually absorbs. We'll measure this in part A. And to do that, we'll generate a curve that shows the absorbance as a function of the FeSCN2+ concentration, which will be known. The curve we'll get will be a line, and the slope of this line is the value of epsilon. In part B, we'll prepare reactions with known concentrations of the starting materials and unknown concentrations of the product, and we'll measure absorbance to determine the concentration of the product. So we might measure an absorbance like you see here in red, and we can project that onto the x-axis in a graphical way, or we can use algebra to back calculate the concentration of FeSCN2+. From there, as I mentioned before, the equilibrium concentrations of Fe3+ and SCN- can be determined from their initial concentrations and the concentration of the product that we just measured. And the idea there is to use the stoichiometry of the reaction and appreciate the fact that the only thing that's consuming iron and thiocyanate is the formation of the complex. So for every molecule of complex that we have, one molecule of Fe3+ and one molecule of SCN- has been taken away. With the equilibrium concentrations of the product, Fe3+ and SCN- in hand, we can just plug back into the Kc expression that you see in the middle of the slide here to determine the value of Kc. We'll do this with several different starting concentrations to illustrate that the value of Kc that we calculate in each case is approximately the same, even though we're varying the starting concentrations of Fe3+ and SCN-.